In this video, I'm going to go over naming ionic compounds, and this is for ionic compounds that use transition metals. So that means we're dealing with this part of the periodic table. And so these are our problems with naming that use Roman numerals. It's also the naming that a lot of students really hate, but it's really not that bad. You just have to get used to doing the problems. So let's go over four different examples here, both going from name to chemical formula and chemical formula back to name. So first, we look at our rules. The transition metal will always be a cation, so it'll always be positive. You never have to wonder, is my transition metal going to be positive or negative? It's always positive. And that means it will always come first, because in ionic compounds, which are a metal and a nonmetal, the nonmetal is always going to be second and negatively charged. And so we're always just going to name that transition metal just the element name, and then the Roman numeral tells you the charge of the transition metal. And this is the biggest mistake I see students make, is that they want to just be like, oh, copper 2 chloride, copper 2, that means I have two coppers. That's not right. The Roman numeral only tells you the charge of the transition metal, and you always know that that transition metal is going to be positive, so it's really going to tell you whatever, how many positive charges you have on that metal. And the reason that we need the Roman numerals for these is because remember that these are the elements we cannot predict the valence electrons for, because it's not always the same. For everything else, we can always predict the ion that things are going to form, because we can always predict how many valence they're going to have. But the transition metals can have different valence electrons depending on what circumstances they're under. So we have to be told with the Roman numeral, this particular transition metal at this time has this many valence electrons. And then the second element will always be the anion. It'll just have the element name with the IDE ending, and its charge comes from the rest of the problems that you do with naming. It's just like that. It just comes from its valence electrons and whether or not it wants to lose or gain. So it's not more complicated. A lot of students always also forget this rule because they're blinded by that Roman numeral. So don't let that happen to you. All right, so with all that said, copper 2 chloride. So breaking this down, first of all, even though the Roman numeral always goes in the middle, it's only ever talking about the transition metal. So we just look at this as one unit, and we can write that down as copper 2 plus. All right, so that's our first unit. And now we know that our second element is just chlorine. And to figure out the charge of the chlorine, we just go to the periodic table, we find it. It's in our seventh column because we skip over the transition metals. And so we know that it's going to have seven valence. It's going to want to gain one electron. If you gain one electron, you're going to have a charge of negative one. All right, so these are our two different pieces. And now we have to make a charge balance molecule with both of them, which means we want our charge to add up to zero. So right now we can look at this and we can see if we just had one of each, if we had one copper 2 plus and one chlorine 1 minus, our overall charge would be 2 plus plus 1 minus, and so it would be 1 plus. And that's not correct, right? We want it to get to zero before we can make a balanced molecule. So that means we have to get it down to zero with something more negative. So we have to add another Cl, 1 minus. And so now if we added up all our charges, it'd be plus 2, minus 1, minus 1, and that would get us to zero. So now we have our balanced molecule. At the end of this problem, to get a balanced molecule, we needed one copper, and we needed two chlorines. So now when we're writing our chemical formula, I'm gonna write CuCl2. That's our final answer. All right, so now let's do copper 1 chloride. So this is again showing you why we have to have the Roman numerals, because these two different coppers had different amount of valence electrons that they lost. So again, copper 1, Roman numeral only talks about the copper. And this is going to be 1 plus, because our Roman numeral is 1. And we know it's always going to be positive. And so now again, go to chlorine. And it has seven valence electrons. It wants to gain one more, which means that it's going to have a charge of negative one. And so now if I add up my charges right here, Cu1 plus plus Cl1 minus, that actually is balanced with just one of each. So I'm completely fine. Now I can just do Cu, Cl, and that's my final answer. All right, now let's go from chemical formula to name. And so also notice that we only ever see the Roman numeral when it's the name written out. Never have your Roman numeral in the chemical formula, because when it's like this, PdO, we can actually figure out what the charge is going to be because of oxygen. All right, so if we look at PdO, we don't know how many valence electrons Pd has. We don't know how many it lost. We don't know its charge. But what we do know is the charge of oxygen. And so if we look at oxygen, we can find it on the periodic table. It's here. It has 6 valence electrons. It wants to gain 2 more valence electrons. So this oxygen, we know when it's an ion, every single oxygen ion looks like this, O2 minus. So that's our one piece. And now we can kind of figure out that we only had one palladium. And so we know that whatever the charge of that palladium was, with just one of them, it was able to completely cancel out the negative charge of the O, and we had a balanced molecule that had a charge of 0. And so now if we just look at this little setup, the only number that fits into that box has got to be a positive 2. Because that's the only number that really makes sense for how it could only have one of each element. So now, if we look at this positive 2, that is going to be our Roman numeral in our name, because the Roman numeral is always just directly whatever the charge is for your transition metal. So now when I'm writing this out, I'm going to have palladium, Roman numeral 2, and then oxide. Okay, so I'll do one more. So here I have AuS2, and I can actually do most of the naming right now, right? Because I know that my transition metal is just going to be my element name, and Au is gold. I'm going to have some Roman numeral that tells me the charge of that one gold, and then I'm going to have my second element name, and I'm going to have the IDE ending. S is sulfur, which becomes sulfide. And so I know my name is going to be gold, blank with the Roman numeral, sulfide. So now let's figure out what the Roman numeral is. So again, we have to figure out what the Roman numeral is going to be by figuring out what we know sulfur will always be. So if we look up sulfur, it's right here. It's in our 6th column, so it has 6 valence electrons. It wants to gain 2 more electrons, and that means that every sulfur is going to have a charge of 2 minus. And in this case, we know that we have not one, but 2 sulfurs, and each one's going to have a charge of 2 minus. So we have a total negative charge from this molecule that equals negative 4. And so now we also know we only have one gold. So if we think about what has to go into this box, it has to just have one gold, and it has to total out to a charge that's going to make our overall molecule 0. And the only number that's going to do that is a positive 4. And so now we know that that has got to be our Roman numeral, because it's the only number that completely canceled out the negative charges we could figure out were going to have to come from sulfur. So this means that our gold is 4 sulfide, and this is our final name. All right, I hope this video helped you figure out some transition metal naming. And just do a bunch of practice problems, and even though it is confusing, I promise it gets easier every one you do.